Going to be talking about his new book, Big, Bad and Heavy, which is billed as the story of a man who lived his life at the breakneck speed of the music he played. So we're going to have a really interesting chat coming up. But first, we want to say a few words about last night's terrorist atrocity in Manchester. Music unites us. Terrorists seek to divide us by horrific, cowardly acts. But as the spirit and resolve of the hundreds of ordinary Mancunians in the city who came to the aid of the injured and the scared has demonstrated, we will prevail. Our thoughts go out to everybody affected by this terrible atrocity. Peace.
I just want to say my thoughts are with the families and friends of all those who were lost their lives and who were injured by this terrible atrocity. And as you said, music unites us. And they will never, ever knock our spirit and they'll never win. So keep on living your life.
Cool. Okay, well, let's begin. Jack, what was it like growing up in Brixton when you were a kid?
Well, when I was growing up, Brixton was a very hard place. There's a lot of injustices with the police and just racism. Just we grew up in a society that, you know, I grew up in the early 70s, and you know what I mean, the racism was rife and black people didn't have a lot of equality, do you know what I'm saying? So it was hard. It was like do or die out there. You had to, you know, go out there and fend for ourselves. And me and some of my friends, we had to go out there and make our way in life, do you know what I'm saying? Which was difficult at times, but we managed to do okay.
So how was it then when you were like in your teens or whatever?
Well, when I was in my teens, obviously I was out of my boys, and when I mean we was kind of in a gang, so we were just running around doing dirt, doing crazy stuff, robbing people, going to Jashaka, skanking, going into Shepherd's, listening to music, and I think from an early age, music was always kind of something that was our outlet. Do you know what I'm saying? And it was just, you know what I mean? Brixton was a wonderful place back then because it was a proper community, do you know what I mean? Sound systems. We used to go to Shepherd's, we used to go to a Beng, we used to go to that Dick Shepherd for dances. We used to travel all over London, do you know what I mean? To follow the sound systems and
Carnival?
Carnival, yeah. Carnival was always good for us. Carnival was always good for us because we'd go and misbehave and yeah. It was good times.
So, what first got you into DJing?
I think I've always been into DJing. I've always liked playing music. Do you know what I mean? From a very young age, you know, I mean, as you read in the book, do you know what I mean? I played music at family parties and stuff like that. Then when I went to boarding school, I kind of got into actual playing DJing music, playing DJing and.
What sort of stuff were you playing then?
I was still playing dub. I was like a big dub head, do you know what I mean? I think it's only later on in life I started reaching out into other stuff and listening to like funk and hip hop and stuff. That came later on because I was just into dub and reggae, do you know what I mean? That was like how I grew up. And it took a long time for me to kind of want to accept anything else for a long, long time, do you know what I mean?
But you got into sort of acid house in the late 80s, didn't you?
Yeah, but before that, I'd spent a lot of time around Jazzy B and Soul to Soul Boys and all that at Africa Center. I used to go there every Sunday night and just check out what they were doing. You know what I mean? Trevor Nelson, who was Trevor Manhattan back then. I just really loved their vibe and just what they were doing. I just got to Shake and Finger Pop parties and Judge Jules and all those guys play some excellent music, you know what I mean? And I just like being around that vibe. It's just, you know what I mean? I learned a lot and just a lot of it rubbed off on me. Do you know what I mean? And I kind of took that on into stuff I do later on, that kind of vibe.
So was it that you started off DJing kind of like hip hop and some break stuff and then?
Yeah, like hip hop breaks and cutting up stuff and stuff like that. Do you know what I mean? And that's kind of the wizardry, the way that he kind of manipulated the turntables. And I was good friends with DJ Business and Pogo and Cutmaster Swift when I was boys. And I watched them and learned a lot from those guys as well. And I remember once business had me on his round his house for about 3 hours, just going bad meaning bad, bad meaning good, and I learned how to do that. Do you know what I mean? It was turn the turntables to the side and stuff. Yeah, it was a lot of dedication, but you know what I mean, once you get the bug, you know what I mean, you just don't want to stop, do you? You know what I mean?
And then what got you more into kind of like more acid-y records or rave records?
Well, the rave scene, myself and Brian and Pete Stewart, another guy that was working with at the time, we got invited down to Clink Street, and we went down, and the acid house thing had just hit, do you know what I'm saying? And going down there, this blew my mind, man. It's like, what is this? Acid house, do you know what I mean? It was like, wow. You know what I mean? I remember Colin Favour was playing down there, Colin Hudd, and Eddie Richards. You know what I mean? Eddie Richards has been a massive, massive part of my growth in that thing, because I worked with him quite a lot, do you know what I mean? And I was on his agency Dynamics for a while, and I think that's it. Being on that agency kind of projected me on a worldwide scale, because I start traveling everywhere, do you know what I mean? But that's where it all started, going to Clink Street, do you know what I'm saying? It was like, yeah, it was mind-blowing first time going down there, you know what I mean? But it was like, once you go there, we got hooked, and then that was it, mate, do you know what I mean? Acid.
And you got a slot on Passion FM, didn't you, Pirate Radio?
Yeah, well, because I was on Passion before the Acid House thing hit. I was on there with Brian, and we were playing like funk and stuff on there. And when we got into the acid house thing, we just changed overnight. And the owners, they were like, no, what's all this devil music you're playing? What's this? What's this? And we were just adamant. We were just like, no, this is what we're doing now. And they were like, no, you can't be doing this, man. And I mean, go back to the music you were playing before. We're like, no, this is us now. Acid house, do you know what I mean? And rave vibe. And then we just, there was no going back. Do you know what I mean? And we got so much stick, do you know what I mean, from people in Brixton. Because Brixton's a predominantly black area at the time. Not so much now, but at the time. And people just weren't having it. Like, what kind of music is this? Because Passion was a reggae station. And like, they liked us on there because we played like rare grooves and soul and stuff. But all of a sudden, overnight, bam, we started playing this music. They're like, nah. And we just said, nah, man, this is what we're doing now. And that was it. Take it or leave it. You know what I'm saying? We stuck to our guns and they just accepted it after a while. Got a lot of stick though over the years for it, do you know what I mean? Especially like just from like general people, like, what's that mad music you play on the radio, man? Just said, this is us now, man. Just cracked on with it, you know what I mean?
You were called DJ Underworld at the time, weren't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, Underworld, man. It's like, what was I thinking? What was I thinking? But, you know, it was one of them things where, you know, it was just, I was a kid and I was just like, I like the name because like Underworld, like underground, gangster shit and stuff like that. I loved all that thing, so. You know what I mean? After a while, I changed the name. You know what I mean?
And how did you come up with your current name then?
Well, at the time we were working on the pirate station, and we were going for a license. We were going for a license for illegal to be legal. So they said that all the DJs and all the first of all, they said that the station has to come off air, and then so we decided that we were going to come back on air under a different name, and all the DJs were going to change their names. Do you know what I mean? While we waited for this license. So I just came up with this name, Jumping Jack Frost. Brian, we all had silly names. It was meant to be a joke, do you know what I mean? But it just hit off, do you know what I mean? It just hit it off, and I kind of had this little Cockney accent to go with it on the radio, and it just kind of hit off, and I just thought, fuck, I'm not going back to that. And I just stuck to that, do you know what I'm saying? And it just stuck.
What did you think when the band Underworld came along a little bit later?
To be honest with you, I'd never heard about them until like recently. Do you know what I mean? I know, like a few years ago, it's not my kind of thing to know. What up to now, I don't even know what kind of music they do. What kind of band is it?
Sort of techno.
I ain't got a Danny about all that, mate. You know what I'm saying? I ain't got a clue. You know what I'm saying? I ain't got a Danny about that. Goes over my head, mate.
But you came before them anyway. You were the original.
Yeah, and I played techno for a long time. Do you know what I mean? So, but I'd never heard of them.
When you started playing at all the raves and stuff, when do you sort of remember the term jungle first being used to describe the music?
I don't know, because it was way before the actual music as we know it now. Do you know what I mean? I remember there were tunes like Bang the Party. We used to call that jungle. We said that little Congo jungle vibe. Do you know what I mean? I don't know, but we just, that name has always kind of been sprinkled around about certain tunes. Do you know what I mean? But it really stuck when the actual break beats and all that started coming. Do you know what I mean? But the term jungle was there way before. I remember we had a guy called Danny Jungle that used to run, my friend Danny. We used to call him Danny Jungle. And that was way before the jungle scene. Do you know what I mean? So the name Jungle had kind of been around. Certain kind of records had that vibe and we just called it that. Do you know what I'm saying? And it just stuck. It just stuck, yeah.
When did you really notice the music start to change?
I think about 93. Right about early 93, you can see the big change in it kind of moving into this kind of breakbeat kind of baseline jungle thing. Do you know what I mean? That we know today, that's evolved into what we know today. But the early parts, what I remember, is from like 93. Maybe some late 92, 93, early 93.
And then around that time, you and Brian G started your label, the label V Recordings, didn't you?
Yeah, we started it. It started before that, I think it started in 92. And
what made you want to launch your own label?
Well, Brian worked at Out of Rhythm, and then went bust. And we had a load of demos, and we just started going through them, and we just came across these guys, Crust and Ronnie. And we just, you know what I mean, Brian was like, listen to this, man. He's like, you got to listen to this. So we listened, and then it just kind of blew us away.
How did you come across them? They're in Bristol, obviously.
Well, because basically, I think it was from a guy called, I think it was, where's Brian? He's there somewhere. Another guy from Bristol passed the demos to Brian. I forgot what group he's from. But he's from a well-known group, but he passed the demos to Brian. And when the label went bust, obviously we still had his demos and we thought we're just going to take them on ourselves. And that's what we did. We went down to Bristol and met the guys. And, you know, we got on really well. And we thought, we're going to start a label here with these guys. And that's what we done. You know, I mean, it was a very slow process because we were all kind of learning at the same time. Brian knew the mechanics of how to run a label, but not like now, do you know what I mean? So we were all kind of learning at the same time, which was because we all grew together, do you know what I'm saying? Which was good, you know what I mean? It's nice.
Tell us about your Leviticus project around that time.
Well, that was around about 93-ish. I've made this record. I don't want to go too much into it because that's like a main story in the book, but that's the main story. This book, yeah, it's like that's that kind of, as you can see, Big Bad and Heavy, which is kind of from the record, do you know what I mean? And I worked with Dillinger to produce this record. We've done everything in about 5 hours, just happened really quickly, but there's a story behind it which is quite fascinating. That if you buy the book, you will read in there, do you know what I mean? But it's actually quite a fascinating story of how the record came about, you know what I mean?
Crazy. And, one of your early signings, Ronnie Size, and well, went on to form Represent. How did you feel when they, a little bit later, won the Mercury Music Prize in 1997?
Well, that was actually one of the craziest experiences ever, because Mercury Prize night, I'd never even heard of the Mercury Prize before. I'm underground, so I didn't have a clue what it was, do you know what I mean? I just knew that it was a big thing, and I was told to wear a suit, and I was like, okay, you know, I don't have to be asked twice to put a whistle on, mate, do you know what I mean? And so we went to the Grosvenor House Hotel. And when I went in there, I was like, oh my God, this is like really a major deal. Because we were up against Prodigy, who else? Chemical Brothers, Beth Orton. There were Radiohead. Yeah, there was quite an impressive array of artists that were up for that prize. So to win it, was one of the craziest nights ever, because I remember it being on TV and everyone seeing us on TV, and I was there with this cigar and all that. And straight afterwards, we all went down to Bar Rumba for a massive party. And obviously,
that movement.
And obviously, you know, I mean, it felt like a win for the whole scene, really. So everyone came down and it was just like a party. Do you know what I mean? It was like probably one of the highlights of my life that night, definitely.
After being kind of shunned by the mainstream, so suddenly drum and bass was in the mainstream. How did you feel about that at the time?
It was good because you know, we got to travel around. We got to travel. We went on tour. We went on tour with Represent. We had these two massive million-pound tour buses, fully loaded with like TVs and bunks and mirrors and everything. It's like rock star business, and we travel around America from city to city on these buses. And it was just like living the life of a rock star, basically. Do you know what I mean? It's just crazy. And straight after that, we got residencies at Twilo in New York City, which is like the old Sound Factory, probably one of the most famous clubs in the world. So we were residents there once a month for just over a year. That's like blinding, you know what I mean? Because I'd leave there, I'd go there, and then I'd go and play in LA at the Viper Rooms after, and then onto. So I had like a residency in Los Angeles, New York, and then Toronto at the end of every month. So at the end of every month, I'd just be missing, and then come back to London. It was just brilliant, do you know what I mean? Well, you can't complain about that, can you? You know what I mean? They're crazy.
What personally, what was going on for you around Millennium time?
Well, around about that time, I kind of went through a bit of a really crazy time. I was absolutely crazy, do you know what I'm saying? So, do you know what I mean? I think the ins and outs of it, I think, is best read in the book. I don't want to give too much away, but I went through a bit of a really crazy time when I had to kind of take a little bit of a break and sort a few things out, do you know what I'm saying? But read the book, you'll read all the details and everything, warts and all, in there. I don't want to give too much about it away because it will spoil the story.
What you mean, you took a break from music for a little while?
I took a break from music. No one saw me for nearly 18 months. I just went missing, you know what I mean? I needed to do that, you know what I mean? I really needed to do that. It was that or die, basically. So I just thought, you know what, it's that time, just face the music and get this dealt with, get this done, you know what I mean? And that's what I've done.
Where's Brian? Because I wanted him to talk.
Brian G!
Because then your label, V Recordings, ended up putting out stuff by DJ Marky from Brazil. And
yeah, because the thing about it is that we heard about this thing called Movement in Brazil. So some guys we were working with at the time, Oliver and Adel, decided to go there. And we found these guys, like, what are you guys dealing with? And we found like this whole community, DMB community in Brazil, that were just like so dedicated, and I mean, and so many talented people there, so we decided to link up with them, do you know what I mean? And we brought the guys over, Marky and Petit came over, and we all know Marky's such an incredible DJ, he just blew us all away, do you know what I'm saying? And Petit with his musical kind of vibe, and it was just, you know what I mean? We kind of had them around the label, and we just took it to another level, and Yeah, you know what I mean? I know at the time, I wasn't around at the time, but that's when we had the record LK, do you know what I mean? And that went to national.
What tune that was?
Yeah, it's a massive tune. It went national, the national charts. And it was a really proud moment for me because I'd kind of, from where I was away, I'd kind of seen everything, but I was kind of out of the picture at that time, do you know what I mean? I just let Brian get on with it, and just kind of observed from where I was, do you know what I mean?
But to have a top 20 record on a small independent label like yours at the time, and also then...
It was massive. It was a very proud moment. I mean, really proud.
And then the guys were on Top of the Pops, weren't they?
Top of the Pops, the whole thing, miming out the whole business. Yeah. No, not really. But it was a really proud moment, man. Really proud.
What else do you talk about in the book?
Basically just, you know what I mean, stuff like, you know, obviously I've got my friend here, Robert, and me and him grew up together. He's actually talking a book about when we were growing up and the stuff that we used to get up to, because we were really bad when we were kids, do you know what I mean? We got up to some real dirt, do you know what I'm saying? We got up to some real... Robert, do you want to come and have a talk? Come on, man, come and talk about it, man, because you can talk, because Robert's actually talking in the book, so just kind of talk about the stuff that we used to get up to when we was young. Have a seat here. Talk about the kind of... This is my friend Robert Blake, and he's talking in the book as well. So maybe you can talk about the stuff that we used to kind of get up to without giving too much away of the story, which is kind of difficult.
Growing up in the way we had to grow up, it was more a survival and understanding how we were going to fit in a place where we were looked at as nothing. Do you understand? It was hard for any one of us to become anything successful, because everywhere we looked, we were pushed in one place, we were pushed back. I remember at times thinking, I want to be white, because if you're white, then you could live a normal life. I remember thinking things like that, you know. So growing up in that era, it was very, 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 very hard in the way you had to think about your safety. Just everything you had to do, go shopping with your parents, you had to think about your parents' safety as well, because people would attack you at any time. You could get attacked for nothing. You may go to a shop and not get served. You know, it was just like that. So it was a funny time, but it was a part of, for us, it was just a part of understanding where we're going to fit in, how we're going to actually become what we're going to become without these people making us not believe who we're going to be. So, you know, that was a really...
Because at that time we were committing a lot of crimes and doing really bad things to people, man. We do really bad things to people. And
without even thinking.
Yeah, without even thinking.
Without thinking at all.
We do really bad things to people. And it's funny that you mentioned carnival, because that was our playground. We go up there and we'd be so bad up there, man. It was crazy. Do you know what I'm saying?
For us, we looked at it as survival. We didn't do it because we thought we were bad, or we thought we were better than anybody else, or we thought that we were allowed to do this. We just thought we justify it in our own ways, because we were kids. We were actually kids. We didn't know what we were actually doing. We knew it was crime. We knew right from wrong. But the way we justified it in the way we had to live, I mean, I don't think people understand what we're actually saying. Living by hand-me-downs, not having brand new stuff, like, that's where it all stems from. You know, it wasn't because we believed we had to have that. If we never got it like that, we wouldn't have it at all.
Yeah, so, you know, sometimes you just got to take it. You just got to take it, man. You know what I'm saying? Thanks, Rob. Nice one.
Is there a sense then, Jack, that some drum and bass music was kind of like almost the soundtrack in what life in the inner cities in the 1990s?
Yeah, definitely, because, you know, another thing as well, when the kind of reggae style of the jungle came out, and I mean, it was a lot of the people in the area that I grew up in, they were like, yeah, do you know what I'm saying? Whereas before, people were like, what the fuck is all this about? Do you know what I'm saying? But when that came out, people were like, yeah. So, you know what I mean? I got really embraced by the community then, like, yeah, Frost is like our hero, like Brixton. And but before, people were like, what the fuck are you doing? So like, people didn't give a fuck. So I found that kind of strange, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, the music at the time was kind of a soundtrack to my life, the Bad Boy shit and all the guns and all that kind of things. That was my life at the time. It was on the record, but that's how I was living my... I was literally living my life like that, do you know what I'm saying?
But then you mean like, because it sort of into the parties, into the raves, it brought a lot of black people into the parties.
Yeah, a lot of black people, a lot of gangsters, a lot of really bad people came to those parties, and it was good times, but it was really dangerous times as well. Do you know what I'm saying?
How did drum and bass come out the other side then and become like, because nowadays drum and bass rave is the friendliest party you can get, isn't it?
Yeah, I think they've always been the friendliest parties, but I think it just had a slight era where it was just a little bit more edgy, a little bit more dangerous, and it didn't last for long, do you know what I mean? But do you know what I'm saying? You know, you go to most inner cities and you had these kind of parties, you know what I mean? Didn't last for long, but it was really edgy and sometimes quite dangerous. But, you know, you had all different factions and all different kind of genres within drum and bass that were all different, do you know what I'm saying?
Are you proud now of the drum and bass scene, how everyone's built it?
Oh, I love it. The drum and bass scene is like, I love it, man. It's like something that, it's like my baby, man. It's like something that I've lived with and something that you ain't getting away with it. It's something that I've lived with and it's something that's just part of me, man. Do you know what I'm saying? We're going to call Brian to talk about the label and stuff like that.
So Brian, how did you first meet this guy?
Yeah, hi everyone. Yeah? Yeah, what's up? How did I meet him? Damn, man, yeah. But, well, by accident, really, kind of like, I was living in Brixton, and Nigel was hanging around Brixton and stuff, and I used to see him around the way, and it was one of them guys that you just didn't want to really get involved with, or one of them, yeah, you just, like, them boys there, you get what I'm saying? It was like, right? But I left it at that, and then there was this bar I was playing at, it was the pub, innit? Yeah. I was playing in this pub called the Normandy on a Sunday night, just playing like rare groove funk and stuff. And he came in with his boys, right? And they're all there looking moody in the corner and stuff. You get what I'm saying? And like, we're just carrying on and just playing funk and stuff. And was that what you was doing? I knew you was up to something. Anyway, all of a sudden, like, the power of the music. This is how good the music is, you get what I'm saying? Because it's the music, yeah. The power of the music. He came over to me and he was like, "This what's this tune here, this tune? I like this stuff that you're playing," because I was playing some like funk and rare groove stuff and all that, you get what I'm saying? And he was like, "Yeah, this is my kind of thing," you get what I'm saying? And start looking at my records and stuff. And I said, "Yeah, you know what I mean? You like this stuff?" He goes, "Yeah." And he said, "Yeah, my old man's got all this kind of stuff and blah, blah, blah. I grew up on this kind of stuff." But he was more into like, I would be playing more like he was more into like the James Brown, yeah, Lynn, yeah. Collins, the more funkier, yeah, stuff, you get what I'm saying? And I was more like into like Clear and Funkadelic and Parliament and just funk, you get what I'm saying? P-funk, like that kind of stuff, you get what I'm saying? Clear and all that sort of stuff. So we're that kind of like mutual connection. And so I was like, "So what are you doing with the records? Why don't you play them and stuff?" And you know, I'm a bad boy, I'm not doing them. You know what I mean? So I said, "No, come on, I'm doing, I'm on a radio station called like Quest FM. And they're looking for DJs, come along." So basically, he thought about it and he came and joined me on the radio station, and that's how we kind of...
You dragged me on there?
Yeah, you came down on the radio station, Quest FM.
The thing about it, the first time I done a demo, I got it wrong. He's like, no. And he brought me to up. He says, "I done a demo," and I said, "No, it wasn't good enough." And then he brought
Serious?
Me. Yeah. Then I came up to your house and he walked me through it as to do the demo. So he had to kind of walk me through as to do the demo, and then from there it was all right. At first it was all over the place. Do you know what I mean? Then he kind of brought me up there and he walked me through it.
Yeah. So yeah, that's how we started on Quest FM in Balham. And you know, my name was Brian G as it was then, and your name was Hit and Run.
Yeah, Underworld, then Hit and Run.
Yeah, that's it, Underworld, because that was your street name, innit? Right? And then Hit and Run, Say No More, right? And it's only when we changed the station and you became Jumping Jack Frost, innit? Because we was on the station, and then the government was putting in lots of licenses, like, to give like the areas, like Brixton and all different areas, a local station and stuff, and so we wanted to apply for it. So the only way we could apply for it was if the station that we couldn't be broadcasting, because we would like pirate station was illegal, and so we didn't want to shut down, but we wanted to kind of apply for the license. So we thought if we get out of the area, come out of Brixton, go over to East London, and change the station from Passion to Lightning, and change all of our names, they would know it was us, and we could still carry on broadcasting and apply for the station, right? But Choice FM ended up getting the ended up getting the license.
Yeah.
And so we said, oh, we didn't get nothing. So everybody, my name was De Niro, innit?
De Niro,
De Niro. And he was jumping Jack Frost. And we said, okay, let's all change our names back to Hit and World and Brian G. And he's like not having it at all. No, I'm keeping Jack Frost.
My show kind of took off. My show took off. Do you know what I mean? I got a call from a guy called Tony Colson Haiti. He's like, oh, why don't you come and play at Sunrise, man? That's like one of the biggest parties at the time. I'm like, what? And then there was no way I was going back. See what I'm saying?
Jumping Jack Frost was better than Underworld and Hit and Run.
It wasn't going to work.
Yeah.
I just kept it.
And that name kind of just kicked everything off for you. You get what I'm saying? And like, you know what I mean? Yeah. You know?
Yeah, it worked. It worked.
And then what made you decide to start your own label?
Just kind of like no planning or nothing. Everything just kind of happened. You know, that's the great, beautiful thing about it. It was just like, it just all kind of just came into place, sort of like working. You know, I was picking up a lot of experiences, just like doing club promotions at Republic Records with like people like Dave Lee, Joey Negro and stuff. I was doing stuff with him and Guy Moot and stuff like that, and just hanging around. We used to like every day in the week, me and Nigel, we used to just go around all the record companies, man. Virgin,
it was release allowed, Mute, Simon
whatever,
Goff, everywhere,
just
it was
begging
everywhere.
Promos, getting promos, white labels, and all that. And then, like, you know what I mean, just to just keep on top. That's what we were always about, just getting the newest music, getting the Guy Moot down at EMI. We used to get acetates, dub plates, and everything. We just wanted to play the music first as well. You get what I'm saying? I used to have a show on Passion called The Promo Show. So I was just like,
Thursday night.
So it was just like my mission every week. So we built up this relationship with all the A&R guys and all the club PR guys and all the record, Island Records, everywhere. They all knew us. You get what I'm saying? So one thing just led to another. You know, Guy offered me a job, said come in and do some club promotion. And then we started mailing out stuff like Shut Up and Dance, the first Shut Up and Dance stuff. We used to we used to promo the DJ Hype stuff. That time his name wasn't even DJ Hype.
Dr. K.
I spoke about it in the book, it's Dr. K.
Yeah, and I remember getting the first Johnny L track came in, Hurt You So, and my job was to go to places like Rage and stuff like that and give it to Fabio and Groove Rider and make sure the DJs got the white labels first and stuff. So, you know what I mean? So all of a sudden, like, the club promotion guy that I was working with, Guy, he got asked to work for Rhythm King. They wanted him to be in-house down there, so he brought me along with him, and we started to do, like, club promotion for Rhythm King Records. And it was all right. It was just, like, Betty Boo and Baby Ford and all that kind of poppy stuff and stuff. And then they said to me, because, like, you know, the rave thing was kind of, like, sort of growing and stuff like that. You get what I'm saying? And, you know, there's all this stuff on R&S Records coming through and all that. We used to play Joey Beltram and everything. So I was saying to them, we need to release this stuff. So they said, yeah, okay. So they started R&S UK. And it was just like to release all the R&S stuff in the UK through our imprint. That went well. So they said, okay, we're going to give you your own little label. So we started a little thing called the White Label. And we released stuff like George Kelly, What Have You Done For Me? And all them little things. And it went all right. And then
the Moby project.
The Moby came in. That's the same time. Moby Go, that was a big tune. And we released that and it went to number one. So, like, there was, like, okay, this drum and bass thing is really, like, doing well and all that stuff. But then, like, they decided to do some cuts. And they had to, like make cuts. And we was one of the cuts. They had to kind of, like, save some money. So decided to just, like, oh, you know what? We can't carry on with this. But at that time, loads of demos were coming in. Loads of demos. And I was listening to all these demos. And there was these guys from Bath that we signed called Absolute 2. And they goes, yeah, man, I got some boys from Bristol.
That's the name I was just trying to remember a minute ago when he was Absolute 2.
Yeah, so we got some boys from Bristol. His name's Ronnie. And he's making some real cool stuff. Have a listen to it. So like I said, okay, I'll listen to this stuff. And at the same time, that's when the Bouncer track coming. Yeah, there was this track and I was trying to get them to release the Bouncer. And they wouldn't release it. And then like XL picked it up and it went to number one. I said, yeah, told you guys, listen to me. You know what I mean? And then like from that... The label went bust. I took all the tapes with me and all the demos. I called Ronnie up and I said, yeah, you know, got your demo from Absolute 2 and we'd love to come down and see you. And me and you went down there, innit? And Ronnie was like, oh, because you got to imagine, it's like, you know, Ronnie's just coming through.
I think at that time, our main focus at first was on Crust, because I think Crust was our main focus at first, because he'd been involved with Fresh Four and all that as well. And it was Ronnie and Crust, but Crust was the one that we kind of, and then we kind of discovered.
It was both of their music. Yeah. So we went down to meet them, you get what I'm saying? And they were buzzing, because it's like, wow, you know, Brian G and Jumping Jack Frost and big names coming down to Bristol to meet them, you get what I'm saying? So we went down and met them, and they brought Die along, their friend, and, you know what I mean, Sav and everything. And we just like clicked straight away. We just like went, I forgot whose house we was in. And it was just, it just felt good. It just felt right. You get what I'm saying? And we said to them, like, yeah, we want to release some of your music. And they were down for it. You get what I'm saying? And like, you know, we had, it was on a cassette, innit? And we was cutting the music off the cassette and all that stuff and playing them and all that. And we got good reaction from them. So
I remember playing like a whole set at Universe, like off the cassette, I cut like my whole set, and I played it at Big Universe, like Tribal Gathering, 10,000 people, and I cut every track off the cassette. I was like, this is crazy, do you know what I'm saying?
Because what they were doing, they were like, I don't know, they were doing like jungle and early jungle and breakbeat stuff, but I could just hear that soul and that funk, something different from what the London guys were doing, you get what I'm saying? They just had a different vibe, and the way they were rolling their breaks and everything just sounded different. I was like, yeah. You know, I just could hear something in these guys, and I just like followed it up, and I'm really glad I did.
We talked about it a minute ago, but when you weren't here, Brian, but how did you feel a bit later on down the line when Ronnie and Represent won the Mercury Prize?
You know, it was a proud moment, man. It's, you know what I mean? It's like, I always feel proud of all the artists that we bring through on V. You get what I'm saying? You know, it's when, you know, I see like Marky, Ronnie, all of them. You get what I'm saying? And even the new guys, them that's coming through now, I feel like their father. You get what I'm saying? And it's just like watching your kids growing up. Serious, it's like watching your kids growing up and doing well. And I'm really proud of them. And that day was a special day for us because no one wasn't expecting this. We just went to this big swanky hotel and Prodigy was over there and all these big guns were all over the place, you get what I'm saying? And to hear Ronnie Sides Represent winning the Mercury was just unbelievable.
And then a couple of years later, you met a guy from Brazil called DJ Marky.
Yeah, that's that all came into place as well. Thanks to DJ Petit. What happened is like we were doing a night called Movement over in Leicester Square on Shaftesbury Avenue. It was really a great night, drum Thursday night. And DJ Petit came over and he wanted to do a movement in Brazil. So he just came over to ask our permission, like, I want to meet you guys to see if we can do a movement party in Brazil. And like the guys that I was working with, Ado and Oliver, they informed me about it, and Ado said, it sounds like a good idea, but let's see what Brazil's like, and before we give our brand, let me go out there and let me see if it's something that we want to associate ourselves with. So he went out there, went back with DJ Petit, and then called me in a couple of days and said, Brian, you need to get your ass over here. It is running. I was like, yeah, serious? Okay, cool. So I got a flight. They arranged a party for me to play at, and it's just like, I went into this place, club called La Vie. This club, and I was like, this is bar rumba in Brazil, right? Serious tin. And I was like, the place was just buzzing. And usually, like, as DJs going abroad, it's all about us. Nothing really happening until we step up. This place was popping off. I see some guy called Marky on the decks, just going crazy on the decks, and I'm thinking, shit, right, I've got work to do here. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to have to dig deep, because he was like, the skills, and he was smiling. Drum and bass DJs didn't smile back then. It's like, it was all moody and serious, you get what I'm saying? And it's like, this guy's smiling to the crowd and waving and just looking happy. I'm like, wow. And the crowd is feeding off the energy of his, you know what I mean? And like, I had to dig to the, I mean, you know, they don't call me the dub plate G for nothing. I had to dig deep.
Boom!
Right, because he smashed the place. And I was like, if I'm the guest, wow, you know? And yeah, I did what I had to do. And you know, come on, man. You know, the G rolled it out. But I was so impressed. I said, man, we got to bring this guy back to the UK. Everybody's got to see this guy, because I've never seen a drum and bass DJ like Hyper was the furthest I see with the scratching and stuff, but Marky took it to another level and he was smiling and having fun with it. Yeah, and it just blew my mind, you get what I'm saying? And I was like, people need to see this. So we just brought him over and, and we brought
You know what was nice as well, because I remember we took him to Miami. We took him to the Miami conference and I remember he wasn't scheduled to play, but I said I was gonna share my set with him. So I shared my set with him, and I think that's the first time people in America saw him. I played the first half of the set, and I just said, come on, man. He came on, and that was it, mate. It was over. Do you know what I'm saying? It was just, proud moment.
It was a great time for with that Brazilian thing coming through. It was good for drum and bass, really good. You get what I'm saying? And, you know, it opened up the doors to a whole new audience and, you know, of people and stuff. You get what I'm saying? With the Latin sound and all that. And, you know, it made DJs have fun when they were playing and DJing. I really do believe Marky brought that to the table, because drum and bass was a very serious place before that. And it was a serious, it was us and them. And just, you know what I mean? And then Marky kind of, you know, made it cool to smile and be happy while, you know what I mean? And not look like you're a cheesy guy or whatever. You get what I'm saying? Because it was just cool. So, and the music as well, he just had so much soul. And it's not just Marky, it was Petit as well. Yeah. And I mean, when you go to Brazil, they're all like that. You get what I'm saying?
All like that. They just love the music.
It's
the
just
passion.
That we've seen Marky and we see Spy and whatever. But when you go there, there's hundreds of them. They all got that passion. They all got that technical skill. And you got to just like be proud of them and say, wow, because, you know, they're less, a lot of them are less fortunate than us and stuff, but they work and, you know, the passion and
I remember
work that they put into what they want to achieve.
I remember one time I was over there and I was with Petit and he's driving and the top of his car came off because he had the car welded. It was two different cars welded together and was driving on the freeway and the top of his car just went shh and just flew off. And it's like, do you know what I'm saying? That's where these guys are coming from, man. So to see them now is just so nice. Do you know what I'm saying?
So, and they got so much passion, so
And then like we were talking about a minute ago, you guys had a top 20 record which has run out of your little flat in Southeast London.
Okay,
of course, man. That was DJ Marky. Yeah, that was a great track. I mean, it's a drum and bass anthem, you get what I'm saying? And you know, the minute I heard it, you know, we just fell in love with it. It was just great track. And then Stamina, who was one of our residents, you know, we was doing this night in Leicester Square called Home. There was a place called Home, and we used to do a night down there, and he'd be singing this vocal on top of it, you know what I mean, singing this vocal, and we decided, like, yeah, let's go with the vocal. And so we recorded the vocal, and yeah, it just went straight off and blew the spot up and, you know, went into the charts, and it was a good look.
Yeah.
I was trying to remember how long it was today, actually. I mean, we started it in 1993, we started V, and we're in 2017, so that's a long time, you know what I mean? But, you know, I'm always looking forward, you get what I'm saying? You know, I try not to look back too much, you get what I'm saying? I'm always looking forward, and for me, you get what I'm saying? You know, we're on the crust of a new beginning as well, you get what I'm saying? It's not like I would ever try and wipe away or move up what from our past, because our past is so rich and great and beautiful, but I'm really loving and excited about the future of V at the moment. You get what I'm saying? Because, like, we're entering a new chapter, new phase, new artists, and the future just, for me, is exciting as it was back then. You get what I'm saying? I'm feeling the same way working with these artists now as I did back then, working with Crush, Ronnie, Dice, Sub, the whole crew, Marky, everybody, because, you know,
the energy's there, man.
So, it's a great place at V right now.
I could just say to Jack, are you proud of the whole drum and bass scene that you've been so significantly responsible for building?
Yeah, of course I'm proud. I mean, you know, I try. Just, you know what I mean? It's something which I just, you know what I mean? You know, I'm a humble person, you get what I'm saying? So I just try to get on with it, you get what I'm saying? And, like, you know, we'll deal with it later on or whatever. For me, it's just about the next thing. But I'm very proud of when I go all around the world and you get the response of people, and you talk to people and our drum and bass has changed their life and brought us all together as well, connected us, you know. It's just beautiful how people from all cultures, nations, nationalities, everything have just embraced and together, you get what I'm saying? Whereas, you know, before I was in drum and bass, You get what I'm saying? I was very more just into my culture and my thing. You get what I'm saying? And drum and bass just opened the doors to so many different people, and it's beautiful, man. So it's great.
Wicked. Thanks a lot, Brian. I just wanted to ask Jack a couple more questions. How long did it take you to put the book together?
I tell you what, I don't even know, you know. I tell you what, looking at it now, I couldn't even tell you. Sonia and Billy Brunt are there, run Music Mondays, and I've seen that they did a couple of books before, and I remember saying, oh, yeah, I'm next. And they were like, you're next, and that was it. It just went from there. And I was working with a fantastic guy called Andrew Woods, who's not just a great biographer, but he's really good at extracting information out of you. He's almost like a doctor, like a social worker. Really good at extracting these little bits of information out of you. I didn't actually meant to go as deep as I did in this book, but I'm really glad I did, because I really bared my soul. Do you know what I mean? And I'm quite proud of it.
So let's bring Billy up, because
Bill, come over here, mate. Billy, I want to call Sonia, but I know she won't come. I know she won't. She won't have it, mate.
So Billy Bunter here.
Come on, Bunter. Come and sit down,
son.
Why
did you want to get Jack to do a book?
There was a couple of things, really. Frost, when I was growing up, first wanting to be a DJ, 89, 90 times, Frost name, Groove Rider, Fabio, they was always the names that jumped out. And when I first sort of started as an apprentice DJ, I always remember Jumping Jack Frost coming down the Four Aces, big bandana on his head, massive record bag, going through the crowd. And I thought, yeah. And just the way he mixed his records, like he was going to break the crossfader on every record, I was like, that's what I want to be when I'm older. So there was that. And obviously, as I started making, we see each other on the hardcore circuit and the Elter Skelters and all that all the time. And then sort of when all the music split up, we didn't all see each other as much, did we? And then there was sort of like the old school revival, and everyone sort of connected again. And there's been three or four pinnacle points that have made me say, Frost has to be the next book in the series. One year we was all in Spain. I like a drink, he likes a drink. And he was, you put your card behind the bar, didn't you? It was like, everyone have a drink. And I thought, yeah, just like I wanted, like, when I used to see him DJ, that's what I would be. I was like, bloody hell, I'm just like him, you know. So there was that. When we did our art gallery last year, the first year we did our rave art gallery, he had some of the most colourful stories. And then there was two or three things that happened, which I don't want to go too much into because it's in the book, but I had a meeting with Andy Swallow. He told me a story. Brian told me the same story within a week, and he told me the story without even prompting him. And I thought, it's a sign. And when he sort of said, I'm the next book, I was like, well, yeah.
I saw it, I was like, I've got to do it.
Yeah,
and at first, I was like, I don't know about this. I only got cold feet. I was like, I don't know about that first. Because I thought, oh, God, I don't want to get locked up. Some of the things I'm going to talk about in this book, I don't want to get banged up after the facts. Do you know what I'm saying? But then I thought, can I crack on with it? Do you know what I mean? Sorry, Bill, go on.
Does it feel quite... you're a little bit nervous putting it out there, the whole book, putting yourself on.
It's actually quite, as the day's coming up to the, you know what I mean? Because within days, people will have their books, do you know what I mean? And they're starting to feel a bit like, ooh, do you know what I mean? Because there's a lot of deep stuff in there. A lot of deep, really deep stuff. Do you know what I mean? It's not all great. Do you know what I mean? It's not all great stuff. There's a lot of really deep stuff that was not too good in my life, do you know what I mean? That I've just opened up about, do you know what I'm saying? So it's quite nervy, yeah.
How do people get hold of the book, Billy?
Just one thing, right? When I read the end of his book, I'm not that emotional a person, but it had me in bits, didn't it? Me and Sonia both read it. We were sat on the sofa reading through the book, and the end come, and I was in bits. And I don't show any emotion. I said to him, I've been in tears of it. That's how deep it is. But if people want it, they can get it from musicmondays.co.uk. That's the only place people can get only our place books you can from. Get
it. People have been asking me, can I get it on this? You know, the only place you can get it is musicmondays.com.
Yeah, and there's free. You can get the book on its own, hardback signed. There's a £30 bundle that comes with a mix CD and a poster. And then there's a £40 bundle that comes with T-shirts, poster, the full Monty. But it's musicmondays.co.uk.
Oi, oi.
So now we want to open it up to the floor, have questions from the floor. Who's got a question for Mr. Jumpin' Jack Frost here?
My favourite record on V Records? It's a jazz thing. The reason why is because of the story behind it. And the story you're reading this book, do you know what I mean? And it's actually the record that got Ronnie and Represent the Dill at Talking Loud. So it's going to be that record without a doubt. But the story, there's a really good story behind it that you'll read in the book. Obviously, it's going to be my record, Big, Bad and Heavy, is my favourite. Do you know what I mean? Yeah.
But then also all of them as well.
All of them, yeah. All of them.
Who else has got a question?
What's been your worst experience DJing? My worst experience DJing was, I've had a few. I was DJing in Hitler's old bank, the Tresor, in Berlin, 20 odd feet underneath his old bank. And I'm DJing and the DJ trying to feed up my ass while I'm DJing. And I wanted to give him a clump, but I couldn't, do you know what I mean? I wanted to give him a slap, but I had to be kind of diplomatic about it. Because, you know, where I grew up, you give someone a slap for that. Do you know what I mean? But, you know, where I was going in my life, I had to learn how to be a little bit more diplomatic. And I was kind of crossing that bridge. So that was a really bad experience for me. But it's something that I could handle like quite professionally now without any problem whatsoever. But, yeah. But yeah, that was quite traumatising for me at the time, yeah.
What other dodgy experiences have you had?
Being thrown off the decks in Los Angeles by a man wearing a spacesuit. After 5 minutes.
Neil Armstrong?
Yeah, no, he looked more like a cyborg, like something from, was it Cybertron, like from Doctor Who? He's wearing like one of them Doctor Who outfits. Yeah, my friends in Los Angeles, they will know exactly what I'm talking about. They were with me. I turned up at the rave. I just flew in from London. I was on the decks 5 minutes and I got thrown off the decks by a man in a spacesuit. Like, you're off, and that was it, mate.
What, did he have the authority to do that?
Obviously so. Do you know what I mean? I didn't want to argue with him. Do you know what I'm saying? He's just wearing a fucking spacesuit,
mate.
Ray
gun out.
Yeah, fuck's sake. About the first 2 hours, then the rest of a blur.
Friday night was your book launch. At
Aquarium. My book launch on Friday night started off really well, and then by the end of the night, I think someone put something in my drink, you know, because I started misbehaving. I really behaved badly. By the end of the night, I was really badly behaved. I need to say sorry to a few people. Yeah, I really misbehaved, and I've had to make a few calls to say sorry to a few people because I really, really did misbehave. Do you know what I mean? God Almighty, drop me out.
Who else has got a question?
Apart from your own label, what's your favourite label in the industry? I've got a few. Do I have to say one? I like Soul. So I like Marcus Intellect's label. It's one of my favourite labels. And I like, I've always been a big fan of Renegade Hardware. Do you know what I mean? Massive label for me. And Full Cycle, obviously. Do you know what I mean? And Creative Source, Fabio's label. Another one, and Prototype, Groove Rider's label. And I think I'll leave it there before I start going on. my favourite ever club which I've written about it in his book, but I will say now, it's a club in Rimini called the Cocorico, which is, the club's literally, it's made of crystal and it's built into the side of a mountain. So when you're DJing, the sun comes behind you and it comes up and you can feel the heat like on your back, do you know what I mean? You look over and see the sun coming up the side of a mountain. And I think that club there and the Liquid Rooms in Tokyo as well, another place I really like, and obviously Fabric, do you know what I mean? Yeah.
Who else has got a question?
Never. Never. Vinyl will never die. It looks like it's making a big comeback as well. Like people started to print up records again. And do you know what I mean? You know what I mean? Brian will tell you, I'm sure that we get a few orders in for old vinyl. Do you know what I mean? Vinyl will never, it will never quite go away. But the digital age is well and truly here. But vinyl will never die. No, ever.
Did you resist moving into digital?
No, nope. I was one of the first ones in the queue. Yeah, I was jumping on the plane with my memory sticks, mate. Sweet, no problem. No picking up that box, running around like that with that box. Because the thing about it, in the old days, when you had that box, you hit against your leg. So I swear, I got a dent somewhere here. When it goes bang, bang, that dent's against your leg. None of that, mate. Memory sticks, sweet. Done. Black Market, hands down. But my favourite ever. My favourite ever record store guy is a guy called Dave City Sounds. Yeah, I swear to God, mate, yeah. That geezer, Dave City Sounds, he's a legend. When it comes to selling you a record, Dave at City Sounds, he'll sell you anything, mate. Yeah, he's like that. Yeah, it's just like, you know what I mean? Yeah. In it, Brian? and the way he'd be like this, like, and he'd give you a look like that. Like, but, do you know what I mean? David City Sounds, that's where Ray Keith got his apprenticeship from Dave. Because Ray Keith worked at City Sounds before he went to Black Market. That's where he got that slippery way from as well. Slippery cunt.
Have you heard Goldie's new album yet?
Yeah, I was actually the first person to hear it. I was the first DJ to hear it. I sat with Goldie. He called me up in the morning. He goes, meet me in the West End. And we sat down, me, Goldie, and Paul from Radio 1. We sat in Goldie's car for 2 hours and listened to it twice. And this is, I just blew me away. And I was the first DJ to hear it. Do you know what I mean? It was so good. I listened to it twice, like back to back. We listened to it, then we listened to it again. I listened to it, then we went out, bought some coffees, come back in the car, we listened to it all over again. Do you know what I mean? My favourite track is a track with Mad Mike from Underground Resistance. Absolutely mind-blowing. Yeah,
I've heard it as well. We've got Goldie on the cover of the next mag, which is out this week, actually. Yeah. The album is amazing.
Absolutely brilliant. That's the track that starts drum and bass, isn't it? Yeah, man. Yeah. It's Underground Resistance, isn't it? Mad Mike.
Redemption, isn't it? Yeah,
that's the tune right there, man. Bad.
Any more questions?
Will I make any more tunes? I would like to make tunes, you know. I'd like to make tunes, but I'm not really a producer. Every time I've made a tune, it's just... And the thing about it, when I look back, I've made quite a few tunes. I think I should try and go back in, do you know what I mean? I think I should try and go back in and do a little thing. I think it's some. Yeah, I think I should. You know, we've got the boss over here looking at me like that. Like, yeah. He's just looking over. So the boss is looking at that, right? So I think it's about that time, probably. You know what I mean?
Great stuff. Well, tell us the name of the website where you can order the book from again.
www.musicmondays.co.uk. Big Van and Heavy. You can grab it now. You can buy all different kind of bundles. Go to the website. You will see all the bundles. You can buy just the book with the poster, the mix CD, T-shirt. You can go for the whole thing. And I hope everyone enjoys it. And I will say I'm actually quite nervous about it because my whole life's going to be out there. But hey, I've got no regrets and I'm something I'm really proud of. And I thank everyone for all the support that I've got for this.
Great stuff. Well, thanks for coming down and
thank you.
Doing such an entertaining chat.
Oh my God, thank you.
And both Jack and Brian are going to play sets now.
Yay! Brian G's going to go in. Yeah, man. Thanks so thank you, man. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Live sets. Let's do this. Yo, Luke, what's up, boy? Yeah, we're ready to roll.
Wicked.
Thank you.